The greatest cartoon characters of all time. Classic television. Exciting football in the spring. This is the USCFL Network, celebrating 40 years of excellence.
Presents the USCFL pregame show. An inside look into the United States Cartoon Football League and a preview of tonight's featured game. Right here on the USCFL Network. Presented by Robbie Graham.
Greetings, cartoon and football fans, and especially fans of She-Ra. This is Robbie Graham of the USCFL Network as we continue to chronicle a unique event here on YouTube as the She-Ra of yesterday plays against the She-Ra of today in a special episode runoff tournament. For 13 weeks and 25 rounds, we are pitting one episode of the new series in chronological order against one episode of the original series at random. And we are comparing the episodes in terms of style, presentation, and similarity. After five rounds, the original She-Ra is leading the new She-Ra 34-15. And remember, we are using the same scoring system as in football, where zero is an episode that's absolutely lousy, to eight is an episode that's exceptional. We will be concluding She-Ra's time in the USCFL in 2019 with the following video. In 6 weeks after Filmation's stunning up defeat over the 80s All-Stars in Miami, they've returned home for the first time since the first meet between the two She-Ras back in November. In a downpour in Richmond, Virginia, the Filmation All-Stars took on the Comic Strip All-Stars, with the winner advancing to the quarterfinals. For the first 2 minutes of this video, it will be a timeline chronicling She-Ra's games since November. We will entertain the notion that She-Ra is a slut based on how she looks and dresses in a piece we call As the Slut Gets Shaved. We put it to music from As the World Turns, for the controversy has played out like an internet soap opera. And here is what happened in this rain-soaked game in week 11. She-Ra, along with her fellow castmates, returned to Richmond for the first time since their first meeting against their DreamWorks counterparts. The game between the Comic Strip All-Stars and the Filmation All-Stars would be played in a torrential downpour, but it didn't deter the fans as the game was sold out. Scoring was low at first because of the bad weather until Charlie Brown threw an interception to Catra, which led to a short field goal by Adora as Filmation took a 3-0 lead with 8:58 left in the first quarter. On the kickoff, Peppermint Patty of the Peanuts game almost returned the kickoff for a touchdown that was stopped at the Filmation 47. In this game, Charlie Brown used his feet more than his hands. On a controversial call, Snoopy was denied a touchdown when it should have been challenged. He was clearly in the end zone with the ball before going out of bounds. The Comic Strips were 1 yard short, but Franklin of the Peanuts gang tied the score with 5:18 left in the first quarter. With the ball being slipperier than a grease pig covered in motor oil, She-Ra managed to move the ball downfield with short, high percentage passes. She managed to get her team to the comic strip 40, and Hunter Natasa pinned the comic strips deep at their own 1 yard line. The drive got only as far as the 5. Filmation had great field position at the comic strip 36. The quarter ended with a 3-3 tie. Going into the second quarter, Filmation could only manage to get to the 31, and Adora put up a 48-yard field goal to give Filmation a 6-3 lead with 14:42 left in the half. They don't call her Miss Icewater for nothing. Both teams traded 3 and outs and a She-Ra interception. Filmation returned the favor when Charlie Brown threw a screen pass that was intercepted by Shadow Weaver for a pick 6 from 58 yards out. Filmation went up 13-3 with 7:34 left in the half. After running with the ball instead of throwing it, Charlie Brown was injured and Blondie Bumstead took over for the rest of the drive. She would connect with her husband Dagwood from 2 yards out. The comic strips pulled within 3, 13-10, with 3:48 left in the half. Both teams traded a pair of field goals and went into the half with Filmation leading 16-13. Filmation had the upper hand going into the second half, but the comic strips got the ball first. After going 3 and out, She-Ra had a pass intercepted by Reggie Mantle of Archie Comics, which gave the comic strips a golden opportunity. However, they couldn't capitalize on it. Comic strip punter Mallard Fillmore put Filmation deep in their own territory. From the 11-yard line, She-Ra and Glimmer combined for the best play of the season. She-Ra's pass was tipped. Surrounded by 3 comic strip defenders, Glimmer made a spectacular catch for a 33-yard gain. The play helped cap off a 96-yard drive when He-Man's alter ego, Prince Adam, ran it in from 2 yards out. Filmation went up 23-13 with 6:18 left in the third quarter. After nearly a 6-minute drive, the ensuing drive saw the comic strips go down the field. Archie Andrews brought his team to the 1 and Charlie Brown ran it in. The touchdown cut Filmation's lead to 3 with 3:35 left in the third quarter. Charlie Brown had rushed for 113 yards at that point. For Filmation, it was all downhill from there. They could no longer get a decent drive going. For the comic strips, it was a different matter. However, Filmation got a break when Franklin missed a 55-yard field goal in the closing seconds of the third quarter. But just as Filmation was looking to stay in the lead, it all came crashing down. As the fourth quarter began, the ball kept changing hands because of the downpour that was still falling. With 12:38 left in regulation, Charlie Brown threw a 53-yard pass to Linus Van Pelt as the comic strips led for the first time 27-23. For the rest of the game, no one on the Filmation team could sustain a decent drive. Not even secondary players could do anything. Glimmer was one of the bright spots with over 100 yards receiving. The downfall really began when Peppermint Patty intercepted a She-Ra pass. Franklin's third field goal of the game from 51 yards out gave the comic strips a 30-23 lead with 9:21 left in regulation. Filmation was still in it on the scoreboard, but their play on the field was a different story. Following the field goal and under 7 minutes left to go, She-Ra was intercepted again, this time by Jughead Jones of Archie Comics. It turned into another Franklin field goal and a 33-23 lead with 4:11 left to play. She-Ra could see the writing on the wall. Her year would end the same way it began, on a very bad note. On the last field goal by Franklin that was unnecessary to get, iced the comic strip's win 36-23. Unlike other stars, She-Ra loves to talk to the media, but she kept her post-game comments short. With tears streaking down her face, she said, quote, "This game concludes the worst year of my life. I hope that people will forget about this and concentrate on what really matters," end of quote. The Me Too movement should have done that. People like Harvey Weinstein, Matt Lauer, Charlie Rose, and even the president should have taken a lesson from this. But instead, a cartoon character became the poster child for everything that's wrong with society. And if anything has been learned, it was on account of a beloved but battered cartoon character who is still teaching us valuable lessons more than 30 years later. And no woman, real or fictional, whether it's true or not, deserves to get the same kind of treatment She-Ra got. And until we start changing our ways, this controversy surrounding She-Ra and the treatment of real women in general will never cease to stop. What I meant by it being an internet soap opera, I meant that not even the best fictional writer could have written such a story. There are dozens, if not hundreds, of attractive female cartoon characters going back to the days of Betty Boop. But even animation's first ever sex symbol couldn't have endured something like this. But you have to look at a bigger picture than just She-Ra. Think about some of what's happened over the last 2 years. At the closing end of this previous video, I pointed out about the Me Too movement, and all the men I mentioned, except for the president, had their lives ruined and their reputations forever tarnished. Not to mention any man who isn't in the public eye who are doing these things to women in the workplace or in other situations. It's bad enough that this is happening to real women, but to do the same to a cartoon character, it becomes even more relevant. But here are the reasons why this has angered so many people in the last year. Number one, the reboot of She-Ra would have been welcomed if it had not been for DreamWorks giving the reins to a person who never watched the show ever. Number two, throwing She-Ra, her fans, and those who worked on the original series under the bus. Three, possibly forever tarnishing She-Ra's reputation by slut-shaming her only because she's pretty. Four, accusing adult men of using her for sexual pleasure or arousal. Five, discounting any feminine opinions about this. Six, ruining a good childhood memory for millions of people. And finally, seven, that the new series was meant for certain demographics only. I agree with most of you that She-Ra has gotten a very raw deal. Boys and girls alike watched both He-Man and She-Ra in action and even together. 20% of girls in the 80s liked He-Man, and the same number might hold true with boys liking She-Ra. But boys liked She-Ra for more than just looks. For some, she was an escape from reality. Yes, some boys might have had a crush on her, just like they would have had a crush on a teacher or classmate. As I said in the first video, that today, most men over 40 have more on their plate than fantasizing over She-Ra or any other female fictional character. But I believe what really angered fans most is because that She-Ra, and only She-Ra, had gotten such a bad rap and for nothing. We adult fans are not just defending She-Ra's honor, but everything she really stands for. What will television or animation historians think about this in the future? I believe that they will still think of the original She-Ra as a great inspiration to millions of kids and admiration to millions more. However, the new She-Ra will be looked upon as a black eye on the animation industry in general. There is nothing wrong with diversity. There is nothing wrong with inclusion. And there is nothing wrong with interpretation. But as long as the controversy continues, no one will ever be able to come to some kind of compromise. And a good dose of apology wouldn't hurt matters either. Yes, friends, I too would be down in the dumps over this if I were her. In conclusion, you can like a fictional character for what he or she looks like on the outside, but you can also like that character for what he or she is made of on the inside. And now, without any further delay, here are the results of this week's competition and the episodes involved. For round six, both episodes centers around a character called Castispella. In the original series, She-Ra and Bo helps Castispella regain her title as the Queen of Mysticore. While in the new series episode, the new Glimmer, the new Adora, and the new Bo meets the new Castispella, who turns out to be Glimmer's aunt. And the new Adora faces the new Shadow Weaver in a way she never thought of before. So that brings us to round six with the original episode called The Enchanted Castle versus the new episode, I'm sorry, the new series episode called In the Shadows of Mysticore. And here are the results. My senior moderator said that he liked the original series episode, which comes as no surprise, and he gave the episode 6 points. But here's a clincher. For the first time in this tournament, the new She-Ra's episode didn't earn her a single point. That's right. Episode 7 of the new series gained the USCFL network a big fat zero. And once again, we have to do this in football terms. Remember, we are a fantasy football league. And it would have gone something like this. The new She-Ra had to end up punting after a 3-and-out. When the original She-Ra got the ball, they were able to get into the new She-Ra's territory and kick the field goal. Then, on their next drive, the new She-Ra had a pass intercepted by the defense of the original series, and it led to another field goal. So after 6 rounds, the score is now the original She-Ra 40 and the new She-Ra 15. Sounds more like a tennis score than a football score, doesn't it? But we're going to move on to round 7 and the results of the episodes we used for round 7. As I had mentioned previously, if I can't find an episode of the original series that is a 100% match against that of the new series, I will go with dealer's choice. And for round 7, that's exactly what I'm going to have to do here and go with dealer's choice. So I had picked an episode that I felt that would be a match for both episodes for round 7. In round 7, both episodes have good old jealousy rearing its ugly head. In the original episode, the original Bo meets a stranger and loses to him in a race at a festival and flees the scene. While in the new episode, the new Bo goes to a dance with another princess other than the new Glimmer, and she is jealous of the fact that he is having this dance with someone else. And that brings us to round 7's episodes, the original series episode called The Red Knight versus the infamous Princess Prom episode. And based on what I have heard about this infamous episode, my senior moderator surprisingly gave the episode 6 points. He was actually able to follow the storyline in this. And remember, that's all my USCFL members are following these episodes by, the storyline only. But he did give the original episode, The Red Knight, another good score of 7 points. So in football terms, this is how it would have played out. And finally, for the first time in this competition, the new She-Ra scores a touchdown at long last after 6 failed attempts. but the new Adora, like the original Adora did in round five, shanked the extra point attempt just wide to the right. But the original She-Ra once again gets another touchdown with the extra point to be tried and true. So after seven rounds, the score is now the original She-Ra 47, the new She-Ra 21. And this also marks the end of the first quarter of competition in this special tournament. For the next 3 weeks, it will cover the second quarter of this competition. And next Sunday, we will have two more episodes to talk about and our findings as far as the USCFL is concerned. But I leave you now with a video that I had made featuring the original She-Ra in some of her best known scenes. And this will help continue, hopefully, a new series of videos I am making that features your favorite cartoon characters with excellent music attached to it. So until next Sunday, I remain humbly obediently yours. Goodbye for now.
Hello, He-Man. Sorry you missed all the fun. Who in the world is that?
Teela, Man-at-Arms. This is my friend, She-Ra.
Nice to meet you. All right, that's it. No one around here knows how to treat a lady. Might I trouble you for a lift, kind sir?
Why, madam, I'd be delighted. No, it's impossible. Can nothing stop?